Scott Sabran's injury. What happened? How did it happen? And what happens next? Stay tuned to find out. Hey everybody, Dr. Chris, orthopedic surgeon and sports medicine physician. Welcome to my channel, your favorite source for information on broken bones and other stuff.
That's a little doctor joke we like to make around here.
Scott Sabran of the Ottawa Senators was knocked unconscious during a head-to-head collision with David Beckus during a game in Boston on November 2nd. He was attended to on the ice by the medical staff, and he was taken from the ice with his head and neck immobilized. He was taken to a local hospital in Boston where he was kept overnight for observation. He was released the following day. In the end, he suffered a broken nose, a chipped tooth, a facial laceration, and a closed head injury. Beckus also left the ice after the collision, visibly shaken and apparently suffering from an upper body injury. Well, if we watch the video of the collision, we can see that Sabran actually came in to deliver a check to Beckus against the boards. And at the moment of impact, both Beckus and Sabran's heads contacted one another. And we can see that Sabran was actually contacted in his right temple. And if we look closely at the video, we can see that immediately, right from the time of impact, that Sabran is already unconscious. He is unconscious on his feet. And unfortunately, he falls forward to the ice while he's unconscious, meaning he is unable to protect himself when he falls. As a result of this collision, Sabran suffers a head injury and a loss of consciousness. And although the loss of consciousness was temporary, he actually here receives two head injuries, not just one. First, he receives an impact to his temple, which results in a loss of consciousness. Then, once he falls forward, he receives a blow to the frontal aspect of his skull when he falls forward and bangs his head on the ice. Two head injuries for the price of one. Even though Sabran regained his consciousness while he was still on the ice, for precautionary measures, his head and neck were immobilized and he was taken from the ice in an immobilized position on a stretcher. He was able to give the spectators and his teammates the thumbs up to let everybody know that he was feeling okay. Well, as I mentioned, we can see that the initial blow occurred when the two players' heads collided. Unfortunately for Sabran, he took the blow in his right temple. And this initial blow was enough to cause a brief loss of consciousness. When thinking of a loss of consciousness, it's best to think of the brain as a computer with two halves, or hemispheres. As long as the electrical activity to both halves of the brain, or both halves of the computer, remains on, then the computer itself remains functional. However, if you shut off the electrical activity to both of the hemispheres at one time, then the computer is no longer functional, and guess what? Lights out. Also, if you disturb the electrical activity in the brainstem, a more primitive part of the brain, then a loss of consciousness will also result. Typically, after these injuries, the loss of consciousness is transient, or in other words, it's temporary, short-lived, doesn't last for a long time. Severe injuries, however, can cause prolonged periods of unconsciousness. And if these injuries are severe and they're associated with swelling or bleeding in the brain, then surgery may be required in order to relieve the pressure in the skull. Now, previously I said that Sabran suffered two injuries, two for the price of one. But if we're being technical about this, he actually suffered four injuries for the price of one. Four for the price of one. Let me explain. Anytime somebody suffers a blow to their head, they suffer a two-part head injury. They typically suffer what is called a coup and a contra-coup injury. And this is a result of how the brain is suspended inside of the skull. The brain is suspended in fluid which is known as cerebrospinal fluid, CSF, inside of the skull. And as a result, the skull and the brain move independently. So when a person receives a blow to the head, the skull moves first in response to the impact. The brain does not move with this initial impact. However, as the skull moves in response to the impact, eventually the skull on the side of the blow bumps into the brain and pushes it in the direction of the impact. This is the first injury, the coup injury. Eventually, the skull stops moving from the force of the impact. And then the brain, which is still moving in the cerebral spinal fluid, catches up and then smacks into the skull once the skull has stopped. This is the contra coup injury. So, anytime you get smacked in the head with any force, you suffer a coup and a contra coup injury. Well, in this circumstance, Sabourin actually suffered two impacts to the skull. So, he suffered a coup and a contra coup injury when he was struck in the temporal area. And this caused the initial loss of consciousness. However, when Sabourin fell forward unconscious and smacked his face on the ice, he subsequently suffered a second coup and a contra coup injury at that time. So all in all, that's four injuries for the price of one. And while it's better that he was wearing a helmet than not, we can't expect the helmet to completely mitigate or eliminate all the effects of these impacts. So what exactly are the injuries that he suffered? Well, as I noted before, he suffered a chipped tooth, a laceration over his left eye, a broken nose, and the closed head injury. And if we look to the video that was taken after his injury, we can see that initially he was laying motionless on the ice. Well, not quite motionless, because if we look a little bit more closely, we can see that after he has fallen to the ice, he is moving his right leg in a very subtle, rhythmic manner, suggesting that he is undergoing some type of seizure or posturing event. Level of consciousness can be classified using a scale called the Glasgow Coma Scale. And this is a scale which gives you a score out of 15 to determine your overall level of consciousness. Now on this scale, 15 is the highest score that you can get, and 3 is the lowest, not 0, 3. If you get a score of 3, you're pretty much a rock. The Glasgow Coma Score looks at three things: eye-opening response, verbal responses, and motor responses. Motor responses are graded out of 6, with the ability to obey commands given a score of 6, and no motor response given a score of 1. Flexor and extensor posturing are given scores of 3 or 2, respectively. So right here, this tells you that initially, Sabourin was not scoring very highly on the Glasgow Coma Scale. Fortunately for Sabourin, his loss of consciousness was temporary, and he regained consciousness while the medical team was working on him on the ice. Eventually, after his head and neck were stabilized and he was transferred to a stretcher, Sabourin was able to respond appropriately to verbal commands, opening his eyes and moving his extremities. This showed that his Glasgow Coma Scale had increased from the time of his initial loss of consciousness, where it was approximately 8 or 9, back up to a normal 14 or 15 immediately prior to his transfer to the hospital. So this brings us to the last question: what's next? Well, there are three injuries here that we really need to contend with: the facial laceration, the nasal fracture, and the closed head injury. Well, if we look at the picture from his Instagram feed taken while he was in the hospital after his injury, we can see that he has had the facial laceration closed with stitches. And we can expect this facial laceration above his eyebrow to close in approximately 7 to 10 days, at which point he'll have the sutures removed. It was not clear from the information that was available after his discharge from the hospital whether his nasal fracture was going to require closed reduction or not. But this is something that could either be done at this time or at a future time if he had problems with breathing or with the cosmesis of his nasal fracture. But at any rate, we could expect that his nasal fracture would heal in approximately 6 to 8 weeks. And while healing, we would expect that he would not engage in contact activities such as returning to hockey. And finally, we have the closed head injury. And recovery from a closed head injury can vary depending on the severity of the symptoms. Knowing at the very least that Sabourin has suffered a concussion as a result of this closed head injury, his return to competitive play will largely be a function of the resolution of symptoms associated with the closed head injury. Long-term effects after a closed head injury can include memory loss, paralysis, seizures, behavioral cognitive changes, light sensitivity, and visual disturbances. Once these effects have resolved and he is able to engage in physical activity without any headaches, then he'll be able to return to play. And the timeline for this is quite variable. It can be anywhere from a couple of weeks to several months or even more. In the end, all we can do is hope that Sabourin heals quickly and that he doesn't suffer any long-term effects from his closed head injury. So there you have it. Today we've been talking about Scott Sabourin's injury. I hope this video has been both entertaining and educational for you. Be sure to like, share, and subscribe. And as always, that's been a word from Dr. Chris, not your everyday
voiceover. Just a flesh wound.